Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Let us pray. With the words of my mouth and the meditation, Lord, of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength, my rock and my redeemer. And the children of God said, amen. Thank you, Assistant Pastor Williams and Reverend Tanika Williams and Reverend Stephen Beckford and our praise team, and to each of you that are out there in Facebook, looking at us from Facebook or our website or YouTube. We thank God for your presence. The scripture was read in your hearing this morning out of Psalm 118. And I'm actually going to read those three verses again, but I'm going to read those three verses from the Contemporary English Version. And 118, starting at the eighth verse, and it says, "It is better to trust the Lord for protection than to trust anyone else." Verse 9, including strong leaders. Let me just say that one more time. Verse 8 says, "It is better to trust the Lord for protection than to trust anyone else." Verse 9 says, "Including strong leaders." Then we go to Proverbs 21, the first verse, and it says, "The Lord controls rulers just as he determines the course of rivers." The Lord controls rulers just as he determines the course of rivers. For these next few moments, we're going to speak on the subject, God decides and we vote. God decides and we vote. As you all know, on November 3rd, millions of Americans are going to go to the polls to elect a president. And so during this excruciatingly long process, these seemingly endless political campaigns will finally be over. No more debates, no more attack ads, no more speculation on who's going to be the vice presidential pick. No more appearances on CNN, Fox News, listening to Rush Limbaugh or Don Lemon. No more speeches, no more campaign rallies with masks or no masks, no more conventions. It will all be just a fading memory. Although a study has just been released that after the no mask rallies a few weeks later, there were an outbreak of COVID-19. In just 2 days, we will cast our ballots. The election officials will count them up and we'll be done. We have decided that as a nation, that which of these two men would become the leader of the free world, perhaps the most powerful human being on the planet, and which one of them will become a footnote in history books or the answer to a question on Jeopardy. Probably most of you are planning to cast your ballots on Tuesday. If you have not made your selection yet, you may still be uncertain on who you're going to vote for, or you may have decided, but you may have made the wrong decision. So let me tell you how you should vote. It's been hoping, I've been hoping for some time that The View would call me and ask me to come on the show to reveal their my endorsement, as they did Cindy McCain and Judge Judy, but they haven't called me yet. And so I have decided that I'm going to share with you. After all, what is a pastor for if he can't help people to make decisions? And here it is. When you go to the poll on Tuesday, I urge every one of you to vote for Joe Trump. I mean, Donald Biden. Now. No, I'm not going to issue an endorsement today. Although there have been many pastors and ministers that have so implicitly, it's amazing how God could be on both sides like that. And I'm not going to endorse because it would be a bad effect for me. It would render your financial contribution to the church to become non-tax exempt. It would make probably half of you mad at me. Not that I'm opposed on that principle. I just rather save it for something later that might be really important when you really need to get mad at me. But the most important reason that I'm not going to endorse a presidential candidate and will never endorse a candidate for public office from the pulpit, it is that it would be wrong. It would be an abuse of my position. It would be elite. It would be an illegitimate exercise of my spiritual authority, because it would imply that there is only one possible Christian choice, that the question of who should be the next president has only one answer to the believers in Christ. It would say to the vote for the one of these men is an act of faithfulness and obedience and a devotion to Christ, while the vote for the other one is a sin. And that's just not true. A Christian in good conscience and good biblical reason could vote for either Joe Biden or Donald Trump, or a write-in candidate for that matter. But I'm not saying that there is no difference. I'm not telling you that, because there are deep philosophical and personal differences among the candidates. I'm not saying that it doesn't matter who you vote for. It matters tremendously to our country and to the world who the president is. And I won't pretend that I don't have a strong personal feeling on the matter, but it would be wrong for me or anyone else to say their preferences are necessarily God's preferences. And therefore, if you are a Christian, you should vote like me. No. So you can make the case for your guy, Biden or Trump. From a political standpoint, from a moral point of view, from a social or a historical, or from a theological or biblical point of view, who you think would better serve the office. You can talk about Medicare, you can talk about the Supreme Court appointments, you can talk about character or Social Security or tax policy or prescription drugs or military preparedness or fundraisers. Just don't claim there's only one Christian way to vote. All right. If I'm not going to tell you who I'm voting for, then what am I going to do? I'm going to give you two principles to help you think about this whole process in a Christian way, and to help you give you a biblical view of government and politics. And then you'll be better equipped not just to vote in this election, but to live both a disciple of Christ and a citizen in this nation.
God is in control of the government and the governors. Here's my first point. God is in control of both the government and the governors. And as you look at our federal government with its bureaucracy, sometimes it's hard to believe that anybody is in control. For instance, you know that part of your tax money goes to an agency that was formed in 1935 that was called the Natural Resource Conservation Service that was set up to help farmers to minimize soil erosion. And now today in 2020, we have 12,000 person agency that has 2,500 field officers and costs the taxpayers a cool $800 million per year. And yet the General Accounting Office has found zero differences in the soil erosion from the areas that participate in the program. And that doesn't work. And if Congress would cut that program, it would save us $3.5 billion over the next 5 years. We waste $930 billion in printing paper that we don't use. There's another agency called the Rural Electrification Agency. Now check this out. It was created in 1935 also, and it was supposed to help bring electricity to rural areas. In 1949, it was changed to expand that they would bring telephone services. And the last time I checked, just about everybody in America except the Unabomber has electricity and telephones. Think about it. If we got rid of that in 5 years, it would save us $1.8 billion. It's not just the size of the government. It's the actions of the government that gives us cause for concern. And I don't need to give you any examples. You can think of the examples of the government officials acting the way they do when you call them into question. Who is in control? But the Bible says that however things may look, however badly these authorities may act, whether they realize it or not, or whether they acknowledge it or not, God is in control. God is sovereign over the government, and every government on the face of this earth, God is in authority over the president. God is in the authority over the Congress. God is in the authority over the Supreme Court, and every federal agency, God is in control. They can do nothing good or bad without his permission. He puts them in the first place, and he can remove them whenever he pleases. If you don't believe me, let me show you some stuff in the Bible. In Daniel 2:21, it says, he changes times and seasons. He sets up kings and he disposes them. In Daniel 4:17, the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and gives them anyone he wishes and sets over them the lowest of men. Let's go over to Romans. Romans said, for it says to the Pharaoh, I raise you up for this very purpose that I might display my power in you, that my name might be proclaimed on all the earth. Romans 13:1 says that there's no authority except that which God has established. The authority that exists have been established by God. And as we go to the polls on Tuesday, as we evaluate the results on Wednesday or days to come, we need to remember that ultimately God chooses the president. God works through the free choice of millions of people with no coercion. Each person makes a decision based on what he or she thinks is best. You see, many of those people have no desire to serve God, but somehow all of those individuals with their free choice ending up accomplishing God's purpose to place in office the one that God chooses. How does he do that? I don't know, but I know it's true. The does that mean that the best man always wins? Well, I was listening to Dr. Pastor John Howard the other day, and they were asking him some questions. And every time they asked the question, he said, first, we've got to understand what the word means that you're asking. So when I say the best candidate, you've got to understand what I mean by best. Always what you want. The most qualified, best suited for task, the most honorable, the most intelligent, whatever you think. No, of course not. Every time there's an election, we have a large percentage of people who are convinced that the wrong person won. But it means that God always chooses the one who is best suited to accomplish God's mission, to accomplish God's person. So whoever that may be, well, let me tell you, for instance, Pharaoh. Y'all know Pharaoh? Pharaoh was an evil man. He oppressed and abused God's people as slaves in Egypt. Yet the Bible says that in spite of all of this, actually because of it, God raised him up. He made him Pharaoh. God did this so that he could accomplish his person, that he can accomplish what God wanted him to do, which was to display his power by overcoming Pharaoh by force. This is a great comfort to the Christian. You may consider Donald Trump to be an admirable fool, or just an idiot, or a New York slicker who got what he did by virtually of his reality show or of his connections. You may consider Joe Biden to be much better candidate, more knowledgeable, more experienced, more compassionate. But if Donald Trump wins again, you don't have to change your mind. You can continue to believe that Joe Biden is the best qualified, but you can take comfort in knowing that God has a purpose for Trump if he gets in office again. We know that God, y'all didn't hear what I said, we know that God has a purpose for him. Now, let's speculate a little bit. Perhaps there's one critical decision that will happen 2 years into his term, and that next president will have to make a decision involving nuclear war, for instance. Perhaps 99% of the cases, Joe Biden would make a better decision than Trump. But in this one critical case, for whatever reason, Trump would make the right decision and Joe Biden would make the wrong one. And for that reason, God chose Trump in office. And on the other hand, God might raise up a leader for the purpose of bringing judgment on a nation rather than blessing it. He might bring affliction and suffering on a people in order to cause them to repent of their sins and bring them back to himself. All or nothing. Maybe God wants him in just for the entertainment value of hearing him mingle the English language for 4 years, or take Joe Biden. Perhaps you think he's disqualified for office because of poor character. You think that his policies would be a disaster for this country. But if he wins, you can take comfort in knowing that God, he never drops the ball. He didn't make a mistake. He chose the man that he wanted in order to accomplish his person. And since we don't know God's specific purposes, we aren't good judges of whether the choice is going to be a good one or a bad one. We need to trust that he knows what he's doing. Whatever you think of the former President Obama, he was in office for 8 years. Whatever you think of Donald Trump, he is in office today and has been for the last 4 years because God wanted him there. God could remove him at any time, but he chose not to remove him. And ultimately, he's still there. even though a handful of senators tried to evict him with articles of impeachment, he's still there. He's there because God's fulfilling God's purpose. I said he's there because he's fulfilling God's purpose. Some folk don't want to hear that, but I've got to let you know that God's in control. Some people feel God's purpose is placing Donald Trump in office was a blessing, and some feel that it was judgment. But either way, he is there because God put him there and God kept him there. Does that mean we can't criticize, or that mean that we can't expose error or wrongdoings or oppose policies that we consider harmful? No, we don't have to change our opinion, nor do we have to just be passive and accept it, whatever the next president may do. But ultimately, we can take comfort in knowing that God put them there for his own purposes, and those purposes will be accomplished, whether or not the man in the office acknowledges it or desires it. God is in control. Psalms 103:19, it says, the Lord has established his throne in heaven and his kingdom rules over all. Our trust must be in God, not politicians, not government. And as you watch the rallies for Trump on television, you see a huge crowd full of people who obviously have a great desire for him to become the next president, for him to remain the president. And as I was reading an article about the American Spectator, one of the writers, he's called them broken glass Republicans, because they would virtually do anything to see Donald Trump elected, even crawl across a field of broken glass, whether it's because they hate Obama and Biden so much, or because they love Trump so much. They are overjoyed at the prospect of their party staying in the White House. They see Trump almost as a messiah figure, some who would deliver them the next 4 years from the Democratic rule. But when this story came out, $750 in taxes, they shrugged it off. When they heard that he had a hidden bank account in China, they overlooked it. They heard him say that this COVID-19 is turning around, they looked the other way. And I have a feeling that they would overlook anything except murder. Although we had 230 people die, that guy is still in the office. Now I'm talking about the Republicans, but the Democrats are just the same. There are some Democrats who feel the same way about Biden. They would do anything they can to save Social Security and keep the Republicans from squandering the money. I said the Republicans and the Democrats will do the same thing, but we can't fall in the trap. We can't put our trust in any man, even a great man. Our trust has to be in God. Who does our trust go to? Our trust goes to God. Our hope for the future has to be placed in God's hand, not Donald Trump's hand, not Joe Biden's hand. It's our nation. It's going to be blessed. It's going to have to return to God and have a spiritual awakening if we're going to prosper economically and enjoy times of peace. It's going to have to go back to God. We're going to have to go back to God. Well, Psalm 118:8-9 says, it is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put your trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put your trust in the prince. Do not put your trust in princes. Do not put your trust in mortal man who cannot save you, because when their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Bless blessed is he whose help is God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God. It may be difficult to remember now, but the political climate that prevailed in the early 1980s when Ronald Reagan was president, the religious right was strong. Organizations like the Moral Majority and the Christian Coalition were bragging about how they got Ronald Reagan elected. Jerry Falwell, y'all remember him. Pat Robertson, y'all remember him. James Dotson, y'all remember him. They were powerful national leaders. And the general feeling among the religious right was that they had somebody in office right now who would be sympathetic to their cause, somebody who would advance their cause, somebody who would finally restore America to its Christian roots. They were almost giddy with anticipation. Prayer would return back to the schools. Abortions would be made illegal again. Homosexuals would be driven back into the closet. But what happened? What happened? Nothing happened. Virtually none of those social agendas were accomplished. Even with the president, who was supposedly being sympathetic to their cause. But the result was a great deal of disappointment and disillusion. I know you can't understand this. The problem was that they put their hope, they put their trust in a man named Ronald Reagan. They looked to Reagan as their political savior. They looked and took their eyes off the true and living God. And so when their replacement savior didn't come through, they were confused and discouraged. Their agenda was not the right one. That's not the point. The point is that we need to look to God for our blessings. We seek for our country and not for any man, not for Donald Trump, not for Joe Biden. If God does bless us as a nation, he may do it through one of these men, but he will not do it because of them. I've got to say that again. If God blesses us, he's not going to do it through one of them men, but not because of them. He was willing. He will be doing it because of his great love. God will be doing it because of his mercy and his grace towards us. Another reason to trust in God rather than men is that the actions of men are under God's control. And so whoever gets into office on Tuesday night, God will use him to accomplish his purposes. If your guy doesn't get elected, it's okay. You might be a little disappointed, but it isn't a disaster. Our trust is in God, not in man. God is sovereign. He can do whatever, whenever he wants to do. He can bring about his good and wise and loving purpose through whom whoever wins the election. Proverbs 21:1 says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. He directs it like he directs a water course, like he directs the flow of the river. The decisions and opinions and plans and purposes of the president are in God's hand, and he will turn them however he wants to. So I urge you, first of all, that request, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all of those in authority, that we may live peacefully and quiet, live lives in the goodness and holiness of God. God decides we vote. God decides we vote. God decides we vote. God decides boat. Just God. I say just God. Just God. Just God. Just God. Just God. And we vote. We vote. We vote. But God decides. Just God. Just God. We've got to put our trust in God and not man. Tuesday, when the results come out, or whenever the results come out, we still walk with our heads up high. I don't care who you voted for, because God has put that person in office. I encourage you, you do your civic duty as a nation and go out and vote. But God makes the choice. God will put whoever He wants to in office. Now, does it stop us from criticizing whoever gets in there? We've got to make people accountable. Because ultimately, God, if they're not doing what God has told them to do, they still got to answer to Him. So I tell you that after the election results come out, I don't want to hear anybody coming to me crying that their person didn't get in, because it was God's choice. You do your part. You do your part. Listen to Him. And the truth of the matter is that even if you don't listen to Him when you go in the booth, whatever way He's desired to talk to you, He's going to do it, and you don't even know that He's talking to you. Whatever you check, we know that there's somebody that's going to be alarmed. But I'm telling you, don't be scared. Don't have that fear. God is in control. He's in control. Now, after hearing a word like that, that the God decides and we vote, whose side do you want to be on? I heard someone say a couple of weeks ago that the candidate, we've got to put our trust in Jesus. Jesus is up there. Stop running around here moping about your candidate might not be there. God's candidate is there. Whatever God willed, that's what happens. You make your choice today whose side you want to be on. If you want to be on the living God, the one that you can put your trust in, because quite frankly, I'll fail you. Might be something that I'll do that I would fail you, but God, you can trust Him. The door of the church is open. The door of the church is open that you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Romans 10 and 9 says, thou confess on the Lord Jesus Christ with your mouth that He died, rose again, that you shall be saved. That's all it is. That's how simple it is. And this walk, when you accept Jesus Christ, He's already looking after you, because He says He looks on the just and the unjust. He's already looking after you. But when you come in contact with Him, you come in contact with Him and He'll take you right in. He'll take you right in. Now, I'm extending my hand for you to receive salvation to Jesus Christ. But if you want a home, a church home, someone that will cover you, look after you, be in contact with you, come and join our fellowship, Agape Fellowship. Come and join us. And the way you can join, just send us a message. You could email us, text us. You can even put a message on our website. And when we see it, we'll get in contact with you. we'll get in contact with you to let you know that you have a family. You have a family right here at Agape Fellowship Missionary Baptist Church. It's about God. It's about God, and we just thank Him. We thank Him. Death could not hold Him down.
You are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King.
Say hallelujah, yeah.
Hallelujah. You have won a victory.
Stand down at the altar. I'm going to read the scripture, followed by Reverend Beckford would bring the prayer. I'll be reading the scripture found in 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, starting at the 23rd verse, and it reads, "For I have received of the Lord, which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
And after the same manner in which he took the cup, he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. And for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we shall not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come.
Let us pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that in the battle for the souls of humanity, you've won the war. You've won the war, Lord. And so we thank you. Thank you, God, that we can come to you and cry, Abba, Father, we can come to you because of what Jesus Christ has done on the cross. Thank you for our soul's salvation. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for what you've done for us and how you've kept us through this pandemic. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. No, Lord, as we stand remembering you at this time, we ask, Lord, that in our heart of hearts, that you help us to carry the cross daily as we remember you. Lord, we're doing this today in remembrance of you. We're doing this because of the thankfulness that we feel, that we're doing this because we're thankful, God. We're doing this because of thanksgiving and thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is thanksgiving. So we thank you, God, for the sacrament now. Lord, we ask that you will bless it as we partake of it, Lord. We don't want to partake of it in an untrue manner. We don't want to partake of it, Lord, because of our shortcomings. But we confess those shortcomings to you now, Lord. And we ask that you bless the sacrament. Bless the wine and bless the bread as we partake of it, as we remember you in love, as we remember you in thanksgiving. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah. take now and drink all. After which they went into the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is our very community with those that are around. He's coming back again. Mm-hmm. He's coming back for you and for me.
Yes.
For the church is out here, and they come again.
I know it was the blood. Welcome to Agape Fellowship, where love is what we do. We are a Bible believing, Bible preaching, Bible teaching church. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, exposit the Scripture, equip and edify the saints, embrace the Holy Spirit, and evangelize the sinner. Out of an abundance of continued safety, as our state remains under a phased reopen approach due to COVID-19, our pastor, Reverend David C. Camp Sr., is encouraging everyone to join us throughout the week for the following virtual ministries. Start each morning with daily prayer at 9 a.m. by dialing 1-978-990-5000. Use access code 345-359. Join us on Facebook Live each Sunday morning at 10 a.m. for worship service. And each Wednesday evening at 6 p.m. for our live Bible study. Via our website, you can view pre-recorded Sunday school lessons for the week. And there are multiple ways you can worship through giving, to include Cash App, PayPal, or by mail. If you desire intercessory prayer from a minister during Sunday morning worship service, dial 1-877-992-4273. For more information, visit us at www.agapefellowshipchurch.org. We thank you for joining us